Mars is mysterious, and it just got more so. Before the mid-20th century, it was imagined as an abode for complex life, ranging from the evil Martians of H.G. Wells' day, drawing their plans against us, and the canal builders of Percival Lowell, and the Barsoom of Edgar Rice Burroughs, whereas Venus was often a hot jungle world, full of vegetation inhabited by something like dinosaurs. That was until we went to those places, and found both planets to be extremely desolate, and appearing very dead. But that applies to life on the scale of the large and complex, not the microbes. What hasn't disappeared is the possibility of microbial life having once existed on either world, and even hints that in some capacity, it might still be there, persisting as relics of a former time for those worlds. This is particularly marked with Mars, but Venus is not off the table. While no conclusive evidence of past life on Mars has ever been found, there have been a series of tantalizing, perhaps almost spooky, hints of not only something having been there, but may still exist deep below the surface of Mars. This is actually not a far stretch to envision, because even if Earth underwent the worst calamities, save for one, that the universe and humans can throw at the Blue Jewel, the subsurface microbial biome on this planet would not go extinct. The one that can do it, the apocalypse of all life, is the melting of the surface of the Earth by the brightening of the sun. And it's simply not old enough and luminous enough to do that right now. By definition, it hasn't done it with Mars either. But in time, it will, at least for Earth. For Mars, it's unclear. While with Earth, the deeper you go, the more intense the temperature and pressure becomes, and eventually there comes a depth that life simply cannot tolerate, but life can go deep, existing about 5 kilometers below the surface of the Earth. That's well deep enough for a similar situation on Mars, probably deeper. And Mars too gets warmer the deeper you go, leading to a layer where liquid water is possible and very likely there, perhaps moving through aquifers. That water is the key to life's survival on Mars, and it may well be there. Mars also bears the chemicals of life. Organics have been found there, and also very importantly, phosphorus. Mars has phosphates, and that, as far as we know, gets it past a showstopper for life, because without it, its function is not replaced by anything else, save potentially for arsenic. But it's not as good, and no definitive evidence of arsenic life without phosphorus has ever been proven. But Mars has ample phosphorus, so the red planet still bears the stuff of life, and seemingly has always had it. But the big questions are, did life ever arise there, or was it ever delivered there from somewhere else? And finally, is it still existing there? All remain unknowns. What has been established at this point beyond a reasonable doubt is that Mars was once covered in liquid water, the solvent of life. Indeed, the universal solvent that allows for our chemistry to occur. And not only is the proof of this present on Mars in the form of dry river channels, it's also chemical. There are minerals on Mars, some suspended in obvious sedimentary rock, that form only in the long-term presence of water. But hidden within this are a series of strange incidents that flirt with the past or present existence of life on Mars. And there are a lot of them, and now we have a new one to add to the list. The new indicator is strange indeed. On July 21st of this year, just a few days ago, NASA's Perseverance rover took its 22nd core sample by drilling into interesting rocks on Mars that the geologists on the science team identify as priority targets. This has yielded a wealth of information so far on the geology of Mars, but so far nothing has been found by that rover that hinted at life until now. The area where the rover found the sample is Jezero Crater, inside a dry river channel that crosses the crater floor, known as Narrativa Vallis. They were looking at the rock, which is about 3 feet by 2 feet in size, and vaguely shaped like an arrowhead, which they nicknamed Shayeva Falls, which is named after the tallest waterfall in the Grand Canyon here on Earth, drilled a core sample from it, and not only did they find evidence of past interaction of this rock with liquid water, but what was inside it actually met all the basic criteria that fit the definition of possible indicators of ancient microbial life. This is unexpectedly weird. That this sort of evidence would be found in a random rock sitting on the surface of Mars may indicate that whatever is going on with it is widespread and common, at least to areas of Mars. Now, mind you, this is not necessarily an indicator of present life on Mars, but a hint of it on the wet Mars of billions of years ago. So here's what they found and how they found it. So the instrument on board the rover, key here, is known as Sherlock, for scanning habitable environments with Raman and luminescence for organics and chemicals. And it's specifically designed to sniff out organics, and it found them abundantly in this rock. The material, which can be termed organic if not once alive, showed up as dark bordered white spots in the rock's matrix, and they basically are composed of the same materials that life's chemical reactions on Earth use as an energy source. Couple that with the evidence for water, and you have a candidate for fossil evidence of microbial life. But it's certainly not definitive. A remaining question that the science team will now work on is exactly how this rock formed and what its deeper history is, specifically if it's been heated. That remains open and crucial for understanding what went on here. Also present in this rock are sulfate veins and Mars's characteristic reddish hematite. The hematite-rich areas where the millimeter-sized spots exist, which are off-white in color, but ringed with black material. The black halos contain iron and, you guessed it, phosphate. We see these types of rocks here on Earth, and they are strongly, in most cases, linked to the past presence of microbes living in the subsurface. Seeing a rock like this on Mars is tantalizing indeed, and it was not predicted or expected. In a way, it's uncannily close to life-altered rock we'd find on Earth. So far as I can tell, the nature of Shayeva Falls has not yet been fully established. We don't know a lot yet. But it needs to be a sedimentary rock to start, which it seems to be. But only having been drilled a few days ago, it's still unclear. How the process that produces spots like this works is that you take a sedimentary rock and start getting hematite, which is a natural iron mineral, to react in certain ways, and it changes color from red to white and releases iron and phosphate. You do not need biology for this, that needs to be clear. It's just chemistry. The thing is, biology absolutely loves the situation because it's a prime energy source for microbes. Add in the detection of organic compounds in the rock, and that's the big hint. Problem is, this is not a hole-in-one, because one can envision situations where this kind of thing might happen without life. This rock, while it's on Mars, isn't likely to prove anything. So what might have happened to form this rock is that it started out as wet mud that mixed with organic somehow and then hardened into rock over time. It then dried out, only to get wet a second, much later time, which penetrated tiny fissures in the rock and started the chemistry that resulted in what Perseverance saw regarding the sulfate veins and so on. But there are other aspects of this rock that were not expected and may yield yet more clues. Another thing they found was olivine crystals. This is usually an indicator of magma, volcanoes, but the rock does not appear otherwise volcanic. This may have happened when the mud was part of the riverbed, and cooling olivine-bearing volcanic rocks released it into the water, and then it became embedded in the mud. The thing is, how hot was it in that environment? Was the rock close to cooling lava and too hot for life? We don't know. And did the sulfates get there because of the presence of a volcano going off? If it was hot, could that have altered the chemistry, causing it to somehow mimic a signature of life? All unknowns. So all that can be done with this rock, to further determine anything is to bring the core sample back in a sample return mission and look at it in labs here on Earth. So add yet another tantalizing hint of past life on Mars. But the future of sample return missions to Mars right now are uncertain. The rest of the indicators are numerous, and all have some ambiguity surrounding them. There was the positive detection of metabolism on the Viking landers, the infamous labeled release experiment that remains an open question to this day, methane plumes that appear to be seasonal, a detection of formaldehyde in the atmosphere of Mars that would suggest that the methane is being replenished, such that either Mars is volcanically much more active than it appears to be, or there is microbial life there. There are strangely behaving geysers that deposit materials around them, that exhibit streaks and channels that behave like seasonal photosynthesizing life. And then there are the infamous Allen Hills meteorite microstructures that may or may not have been evidence of fossilized bacterial life. But there have been two other geologic indicators that are very strange indeed, because both were detected on Mars' surface and do not have ready explanations. One is obscure. I've mentioned it long ago in a video, but it's very puzzling. It involves apparent fossil microbial mats. Here on Earth, these mats form in shallow water, lakes, and coastal areas, and unequivocally are products of life. If nothing disturbs them, these mats can fossilize, and are actually among the oldest fossil evidence we have for life on Earth. Here's the weird thing. NASA's Curiosity rover found what appeared to be a fossilized microbial mat on Mars. In this case, the rock is sedimentary and exhibits domes, roll-ups, and pits that make it look like a microbial mat. We'd call it that if it were here on Earth. But it's on Mars, and shaped rocks are notoriously difficult to interpret. But it's yet another hint. And now for the really weird one that's been forming up over the last few years. So on Earth, organisms interact with their environment, the substrate, and on Earth offer direct evidence of biological activity. This can be a range of things, but a major one are microscopic, Proterozoic, and Archean microorganism borings. When these fossilize, they are known as ichnofossils. And here's the strange thing. We found them on Mars. And not just once, but there are two corroborating examples of these potential fossils. In the Vera Rubin Ridge region of Mars, inside Gale Crater, a different crater here, the Curiosity rover found tiny elongated structures in sedimentary rocks that bear a strong resemblance to ichnofossils, and basically nothing else. It's not slam dunk evidence though, because it's thought possible that a type of crystal growth, and even cracking in the rock, might mimic ichnofossils on Mars. But then comes the corroborating evidence. This comes from the Martian meteorites, and some samples show the same type of tunnel, both curved and straight in path. But here's the odd thing. These tunnels show traces of carbon in higher abundance than what would be expected. These are seen in volcanic glasses on Earth, but aren't volcanic themselves. They're caused by biology. And as intriguing as it is, that's where this work sits. Much more analysis and work needs to be done to further try to characterize these structures. But since they are in meteorites from Mars that we already have, it seems likely that in coming years we will know more, as long as someone looks into it further. And this leads to a strange speculation on my part. Venus also has a similar grouping of hints, suggesting that there may be microbial life in a layer of its upper atmosphere. Earth, we already know, has life, and Mars is also hinting. Imagine if it were found that all three have or had microbial life. The meaning of it is profound because it can only mean one of two things. If that life were to prove panspermic, meaning that it all originated on the same body and was transported elsewhere in the solar system, then the question has to be asked. Which body originated life? Earth would have one chance in three, having been the origin point, but if it's not, then life on Earth, us, is not indigenous to this planet, and it all started on Mars or Venus, or maybe somewhere else. Conversely, if all three worlds is genetically unrelated and show distinct incidences of abiogenesis, then not only did the star system host three water worlds that spawned life, that alone would suggest that surface habitable terrestrial water planets are common in the universe, but also that abiogenesis must be very easy, and the universe flat out teems with at least microbial life, deepening the great mystery of why we don't see evidence of this already. Maybe we aren't as far from finding it as we think. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently perplexed again. This video is about planets, but we're also finding evidence in asteroid samples of material that came in the past in contact with liquid water, suggesting that there was a watery protoplanet in the solar system very early on, maybe more than one. It's very speculative, but it might be possible that life formed on that protoplanet originally and was transferred across the solar system, and then it was hit by another protoplanet, meaning that the homeworld of life on Earth was completely destroyed. Reminds me of Alderaan, Death Star indeed. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.